Hello, and welcome to Viavi Solutions webinar series on fiber to the antenna installation. My name is Jennifer Faircloth, and I'm a senior marketing manager here at Viavi. This webinar will cover front haul test. Our presenter is Joe Gomez, senior product manager for Viavi. Other webinars in the series cover fiber inspection and connectivity, cable and antenna test, and fiber certification. To access all of the webinars and related material, please visit viavisolutions.com/FTTA. Now, Joe, please take it away.
Well, thank you very much, Jennifer. My name is Joe Gomez. I'm a product manager, as Jennifer may have already told you. We're going to be looking at some of the issues or some of the things that we will be encountering during a front haul installation. So if you take a look at what the front haul life cycle looks like, we really need to understand the needs behind the front haul. The construction or installation of the front haul is definitely not the first phase, and it's really, if done properly or as done properly, you need to, you know, cycle through and go through initial construction, installation as, you know, equipment gets improved throughout the years. Every time you do that, you need to have a commissioning slash acceptance phase. Then after acceptance, it goes into maintenance mode, where primarily you'll be just doing troubleshooting, maybe some add deletes. Ideally, you'd be looking at some optimization, and then you're probably back to leveraging the current construction that has been in place and doing additional installations. A significant amount of planning went into the site selection. So there are a significant number of parameters that need to be configured during the installation phase of the front haul. If you look at installation, it's typically performed by multiple teams cooperating with each other to deliver a, you know, high quality site slash installation, and at the end of that step, the commissioning acceptance phase verifies the construction is complete, the installation is complete, before you know, putting the site into maintenance. So if we take a look at the deployment life cycle and the working groups that are involved during the construction phase, if the tower doesn't already exist, or the pole or the site doesn't already exist, of course you have to go ahead and erect the tower. But there's also a phase where construction team riggers come in, they install fiber to the top of the tower or top of the pole or top of the roof. They mount the remote radio head, and of course, you know, any other item that needs to be put in, such as, you know, electrical power, you know, satellite antennas, so on and so forth. During the second step, a cell site technician or a technician slash engineer provided under contract provided by the network equipment manufacturer or a subcontractor comes in and installs what's known in 4G LTE parlance as the BBU, the baseband unit. Switches and routers are installed. The baseband unit is connected to the remote radio head, which was installed during step one. And the backhaul is connected for the first time. And then at that point, you go into the acceptance slash commissioning phase, or the acceptance of the site, where either a cell site technician comes and runs a set of tests to verify that everything was correctly installed, or reports generated by the commissioning activity and the installation activity are handed off and reviewed to ensure that everything is working properly. And then finally, in step four, is when you make that crossover into the maintenance phase. So what challenges are faced, are typically faced when installing the front hall? And the answer to that is going to be driven by who you ask or whose perspective you're looking at. So if you take a look at it from the service provider perspective, their point of consternation is usually consistency in testing. They want to make sure that everything is tested properly to hopefully increase the installation quality and avoid any maintenance problems from the start. Optimizing and, of course, improving the installation process hopefully reduces delays. So from this perspective, the installation quality and the short delays are important, but the installation quality has a couple of components to it. If the service provider themselves are going to be doing maintenance on the cell site, then of course they want to get something that comes in clean. If the maintenance is going to be contracted out to a third party, maybe the same organization that was the prime contractor for the installation, maybe someone different, you still want to make sure that it was a quality installation, because your user's service will be affected if it was not. Lastly, I guess the service provider, amongst their top concerns, is improving the contractor efficiency as well, so they don't have to not just take long delays, but also have the installation process be as costly as it is. From the contractor perspective, you want to improve the quality of the work to reduce free rework. Now, it's not really free rework, it's getting the job done right. As an installation company, you want to make sure that the number of times that you have to touch the same installation, the same circuit, the same fiber, and touch it again and again until you get it right is reduced, because it's just not very efficient, and that cuts into the bottom line. You also want to make sure that the documentation deliverables are easy to produce so that you can accelerate the closeout of the ticket or the closeout of the activity, and can turn around and accelerate the speed at which you deliver proof of completion to the service provider, so you can have that ticker start as far as receiving payment. You also want to improve efficiency, so you can, in general, improve project profitability, whether you pass that on or not to the service provider. So if we take a look at a front hall installation, it's very complex. It's a very complex job to do it right. Yeah, you're putting a remote radio head at the top of a tower. You're feeding it power, you're feeding it fiber optic, you're connecting it to a few junction boxes. That's not a big deal. This is the step one process, right? So when we look at step one, you tend to see everything not obfuscated by the purple as being done in step one. And you can see that there's a whole bunch of different things that are important to do. For example, the fiber. It's important that you inspect the fiber to make sure that it's clean, because if it's not clean and you put a and you can connect a couple fibers together, you'll be causing permanent damage to the fiber that in the future will hamper its usability or reusability. And if you happen to try to reuse it and reconfigure the speed on it, increase the speed of data that you're passing across that fiber, you could very well find yourself in a situation where you start taking bit errors. Additionally, you should attach an OTDR and test for insertion loss, reflectance, optical power, any impairments. And that will probably be the best way you can go ahead and certify that everything from the RRH all the way down to the baseband unit has fiber-wise, physical layer installation-wise, has been properly performed. After that's done, then really you go into the next phase where you go in and start verifying that the remote radio head has been properly configured and is working properly. So some of the things that you would look at is the antenna tilt, the VisWar. You probably want to log into the remote radio head and check that the optic that it has is correct, that it is running the correct firmware version, and all that basic stuff, as well as leverage the fact that the antenna is already installed and the remote radio head is already installed, and do a little bit of PIM detection to see if there's any intermodulation problems, some interference analysis, check for diversity and balance. Lastly, if you're also installing a satellite antenna, you want to make sure that that satellite antenna has a clear view of the sky over a long period of time and can see multiple satellites. Now, all that is typically done as a step one type of installation. Sometimes step one installation may also include the installation of a microwave backup in case you do not have fiber going to that cell site. If you're installing microwave, there are an additional series of tests that are prudent to run to make sure that everything is configured properly and that everything will be running cleanly. So because of the complexity of a cell site front haul installation, we really recommend an all-in-one type of solution, such as a T-Bird 5882 with different additions to it, such as the OTDRs, the fiber microscope, and a job manager that can track all the different tests that you need to run, grab their results, and be ready to generate a summary closeout report. Usually, all these series of tests, even though they seem very daunting, could be done in 30 minutes or less. So let's take a look at what the job manager actually is. It's a workflow tool that's included with T-Bird 5800 at no additional cost. And what it does is it executes test plans that have been created prior to going to a job site, making it easy to load test templates and making it easy to have customizable job guidance to make sure that there aren't no tests that get forgotten, and therefore that the testing is as complete as possible and the quality of the job is as high as it can be. It also helps improve efficiency, because if you follow all the tests that have to be done in the job manager, it gives you a certain sense of repeatability, both if you're testing this cell site multiple times, going back to the cell site, testing it in once it's in maintenance phase because there was a change, there was a problem, etc., or cell site to cell site to make sure that all the cell sites have been installed with the same procedure that has improved the quality. It also makes it easy to close out jobs by creating summary reports from all the different multiple tests that need to be performed. And mind you, some of the tests, for example, you go in and you apply a fiber microscope to a piece of fiber, you see that it's dirty, you have to stop, clean it, test it again, make sure it's clean, and repeat that multiple times with multiple fibers going up to multiple antenna sectors until you get them all clean. So that could be relatively tedious, but the job manager makes sure that you follow through and you do all those tests, and it collects the results from multiple reports. The job manager is really not required to run a test. So if you want to, you know, go off in your own direction or run into a problem that's particularly different or that deviates a lot from what you would typically do, then you can actually, you know, turn the job manager off and, you know, run whatever tests, as many tests as you need to run independently until, you know, you've run that problem to ground. It's not a paid feature or a subscription service. It's something that comes with every T-Bird that we sell. It does not dictate what are the good pass-fail parameters. That's something that you need to decide for yourself and load a corresponding test template that has that information. It does not require there to be a test plan administrator, somebody who creates all the test plans that everybody uses, and it doesn't force a workflow. It's a checklist. So for example, if you prefer to test the fiber and then automatically run the CPRI check to make sure that that sector is working correctly and that the RRH is set up correctly, and then go to the next pair of fibers and run and check those fibers, and then run an OTDR on those fibers, and then run the CPRI check on those. You could do it that way, or you can inspect all the fibers, run all the OTDR traces, and then finally come back and run all the CPRI checks. So it really doesn't force a very specific workflow. It's really more of a checklist. So what are some of the benefits to creating a test plan before testing? If you have, and you can see that you have when you're installing the front haul, relatively complex jobs with many multiple tests. It helps you reduce the typing because you fill out the job information once before you even get to the site, and it eliminates the need to recursively fill out that information over and over every time you run a test. It provides technicians the guidance or the checklist that they need to ensure that all tests are completed and that none are missed. And additionally provides visual guides with embedded guidance. It creates a summary status, a single summary report that has comprehensive proof that all tests were passed with the pass-fail criteria, and all the test details are still available in the comprehensive report. And lastly, it makes sure that the job gets done right, that the quality remains high, avoids time-consuming manual documentation steps, which from a contractor perspective should be a key. Nobody wants to spend an entire week installing a cell site and then lose another half day to three quarters of a day compiling documentation so that you can turn around, hand that in, and get paid for the job. If you can do that in a comprehensive 30-minute closeout report, you're in much better shape. The job manager makes every technician an expert. All they have to do is follow the plan, and they'll be delivering quality installations time and time again. So if we take a look at what the job manager is in detail, you can see here that the load job gives you the opportunity to select among different jobs that may have been, or test plans that may have been pre-configured and saved on your test set. The job information is something that it's applied to all the reports, and you get the test plan view, which is a sequence of all the different tests that could be run and their status. Are they still open? Have they been completed? Are they in progress? You can launch each test one at a time in any order. And if you click the button that says guide, it'll give you customizable guidance. When you're done with all your tests and the status is complete on everything, just go ahead and click create report. If you get stumped and you run into something that's particularly difficult to resolve, or get interrupted and have to run off and work on a different job, you can always click deactivate job and stop saving test results and tests for that are part of this test plan. The once you press the guide button, the guide gives technicians a thorough step-by-step guidance. It's a PDF document that gets loaded directly on the test set, and after reading the guidance, the technician can also hit launch here and launch into the test directly directly from the screen. This PDF document, we do ship the 5800 with samples, but these can be customized by service providers, by technician supervisors, by project managers, by anyone themselves, and stuff like a picture of the device, a picture of the switch, a picture of the port can be directly shown to make it easier for the technician to identify exactly where they need to plug in to run the test. So now the big question is, wow, sounds like, it does a lot, but sounds like there's some concerns here, because the big question is, who owns a test plan? Who's going to get stuck with all this? And really, it's up to the person that owns a test set or the person that owns the testing to decide. The test plans could be tech created. You could have a technician that goes off, hits our free webpage, creates a test plan for their jobs, saves a test plan, loads it on the T-Bird, and then runs off to the test site and does it. Or the test plan could be created by a third party, whether that's a project manager, a project lead, a lead technician, an engineer, and they can turn around and communicate to the technician exactly what needs to be done by creating the test plan. And they can go ahead and email the test plan to the technicians, who would then load it on the instrument and follow the test plan. This approach creates increased efficiency and alignment on the job tasks. And thirdly, depending on the organization, you can have the test plan created automatically via an API that plugs directly into an OSS or a ticketing system the moment the need for the job is created in the ticketing system or the OSS. That software can also go out and create the test plan. Again, this is a highly efficient way. Our API is available for free to customers for them to decide if this is the way that they want to approach testing and using the workflow tool called the job manager. So what are some of the things that are run in the typical front hall installation with the job manager. Well, one of the most comprehensive things that we have is our CIPRI check workflow that includes the ability to take a look at the RF coming through the fiber or through the CIPRI. It starts off by doing a local optic check to make sure that the optic that is being used is the right one to support the CIPRI rates. Then it looks at whether the interface comes up at the right speed, whether CIPRI is in fact running, and whether it actually gets to complete the CIPRI startup sequence and reports on that. After these initial checks are done, the CIPRI check then moves on and does a round trip delay test with the remote radio head to make sure that everything is working. Now, the round trip delay test may seem silly if you're actually sitting at the bottom of the tower, but if your fiber or your connection to the remote radio head after it's installed all the way to the base of the tower connects into a WDM network and actually the signal travels over a few kilometers, then the round trip delay test is valuable because you want to make sure that you are within the network equipment manufacturer recommendations for round trip delay. Afterwards, the CIPRI check starts talking to the remote radio head and extracting identification information that's useful. After that, it will go and do an antenna tilt test. It'll query the radio head for VisWire. It will query the remote radio head for diversity imbalance and check the RX power on multiple antennas. And then it'll finally go out and detect PIM. So if we take a look at what the RRH identification does, it actually logs into the remote radio head and reports information about it, such as who is the manufacturer, the model number and serial number, and the software version that it's running. It also gives you the number of antennas that are configured for transmitting and receiving. So this information could be very valuable to A, make sure that you're on the right software version, B, that you're connecting to the right remote radio head. You're not trying to mismatch a Nokia radio head to an Ericsson BBU, and make sure that the right model remote radio head was installed. Second thing to look at is the RET test, the antenna tilt. You have the opportunity to go ahead and set or reset the antenna tilt if it's not correct. If you're using this as your main installation tool, then this is probably the time and the place where you want to set the remote tilt. If you've configured that before, then all this step does is a quick confirmation that it was configured properly before. You have the ability to calibrate the antenna and clear alarms. You also have the ability to configure antenna tilt on multiple different antennas. The next thing you want to do during the front haul installation is check the VisWire. So big question is, what is VisWire? That stands for voltage standing wave radio and is a measure of how efficiently radio frequency power is being transmitted from a power source through a transmission line, in other words, through the coax into the antenna. In an ideal system, 100% of the energy is transmitted. we know that that is ideal. We know it's never going to be 100%. In real systems, some of the power is reflected back towards the source, kind of like an echo. And the reflections of the power can actually cause destructive interference. So what Vizuar does is measure these voltage variances. According to the mathematical way it's calculated, the closer the number is to one, the better the value. So in this test case here, you see that TX antenna one Vizuar was at 1.073. You could set a pass-fail threshold here and say if Vizuar ever gets over 2, we're going to go ahead and fail this and then have to go ahead and rerun the CPRI check test until we get it to pass. And some troubleshooting information is, you know, always, of course, provided TX power, incident power, reflected power, so on. Diversity and balance. So what is that? And it's a measure of the received powers on up to 4 different antennas. What you're looking for is trying to ensure that the power being received is similar across the different antennas. The diversity imbalance test measures the relative power of these antennas that are attached to the remote radio head. And this test is specifically done to make sure that the gain has been properly configured on the antennas. That is the idea behind the diversity and balance test, to confirm that the gain has been properly configured and that all the different antennas are close to each other. You can configure, of course, a floor DBM and a threshold, where if that threshold is exceeded, then you get a fail. Probably the last test that you'll run on the CPRI check is the PIM detection test. And we all know why PIM is important. And let's just review what PIM is. PIM stands for passive intermodulation, and it's the generation of interfering signals caused by nonlinearities in the components. In other words, two signals mix together and they'll generate an interference. This usually happens anywhere that, you know, two different metals come together, like copper to aluminum, the non-linear effect is usually caused by items such as rust, corrosion, loose connections. Loose connections are very, very prevalent. Dirt, oxidation, any similar type of contamination, and even nearby metal objects can cause this passive intermodulation, this mixing of frequencies. Usually happens when two RF frequencies are relatively close, the higher the power used, the greater the PIM signals that are generating. Interfering signals can raise a noise floor and block desired or good signals. The end effect will be drop calls, decreased system capacity, slower data rates or decreased data rates. The way this test runs is that the T-Bird connects into the remote radio head and instructs the remote radio head to transmit at maximum power. And then it uses the receiver to listen to see if there's any interference. And it'll automatically calculate the difference in slope. And if it sees that difference, it'll call PIM and fail the PIM detection test. So here, of course, you can set On the PIM test, you can set the bandwidth percent and the pass-fail criteria as far as dB across up to four different antenna. And you should be able to visualize PIM in the spectrum. So these here, you can see they're relatively flat tops. That usually means that there isn't PIM. Usually when they're sloping in either one direction or the other, that's a sign of PIM. And lastly, for the RAN installation, one of the tests that you will typically run into or typically may have to do is a satellite antenna installation test. And what you're trying to do is verify that the satellite antenna, based on where it's installed, has no blind spots and it isn't blocked from line of sight to satellites. The best way to run the installation test, of course, you could run it as a show me what's up in the sky right now. That may be good, but really what you're interested in is taking a look at the CNO spectrogram, because the spectrogram runs over a 12 or 24 hour period. It's your choice. Keep in mind the satellites typically follow an orbit that's 11 hours, 57 minutes. So something as short as a 12 hour test would be good enough to confirm that you have good signal strength from multiple satellites. And the way this test works, and this is a long-term test that you probably want to perform the night before last after handing over the cell site, is every sector of the sky that has a good strong that has a satellite signal, it will paint it with a color. If the color is green, that means that the signal to noise ratio, it's in the higher area and stronger, and the chances are that you're seeing the satellite directly is much higher rather than seeing a reflection of the satellite signal as it bounces off a building or goes through a building or something else. The stuff down here towards the left in the purple and the blue, that means that the signal is not as good, not as strong. Of course, that is something that you would expect on the outer rims of the circle, because the outer rims of the circle is closer to 100% horizontal. In other words, closer to the horizon. And the closer you are to the horizon, the more the satellite signal gets affected by atmospheric effects. Now, we have seen this picture before, and I removed a whole bunch of the information of all the tests that are recommended to be run during the front haul. Again, tests that we believe could be done in 30 minutes or less, including all the CPRI check functions, running the OTDR traces, and inspecting a transmit and a receive fiber. Of course, if you're doing multiple fibers in multiple sectors, it'll be 30 minutes times, you know, every sector that that you're setting up that day on this tower. But in the case of microwave backhaul, if your backhaul is not through terrestrial landline type of situations, if it's not through fiber or some other landline mechanism, another popular form of Ethernet backhaul is over microwave. And there's a few things that need to be validated. For example, it's quite common to use RJ 45, some sort of category X 6-7 shielded twisted pair to go to connect to the microwave into the cell site router. And in those situations, it's quite common as well to use an injector and provide power over Ethernet into the microwave. That way you have less cabling to run and deal with from wherever you install the microwave on the tower all the way back to the cell site router. If you're using RJ45, it's highly recommended that you run a cable diagnostic to make sure that everything is working correctly. A simple wire map test. You should also test shield ground continuity. Run a little bit of traffic. Once that is done, the other thing that's really important to do is to make sure you do some sort of per hop bit error rate test. And that bit error rate test could be something as complete and as an RFC 2544 or a Y.1564 that usually work at layer one and layer two and layer three, or an RFC 6349 that actually works at layer four TCP. It could be as simple as a quick check. It could be as simple as let me send traffic and let's configure the far end to go ahead and reflect it back and do a loop back at the far end. All these tests have configurable pass-fail, and the real KPIs that you're looking for are, am I hitting the throughput that I want to hit? Is my jitter delay, frame loss rate, and burstability what I expect it to be? Those are different items that you probably do want to test when running this. And the reason you want to do a per hop Ethernet BERT test is that, you know, unlike a centralized automated test where you could actually go from a central location, configure the cell site router to loop back, you know, run some traffic and take it back and make sure that everything is relatively good. If you try to do that same test over microwave, you will lose the ability to figure out if your microwave is properly tuned for the environment. Does it have the right tilt? Does it have the right gain? Is the right amount of power being applied? And those are subtle little things that you can configure on the microwave, run the BERT test, make sure that you're hitting your throughput, you're hitting your frame loss rate, and that it's looking good. That is much simpler to do with a test set at the site than try to do that with someone over the phone in a center and try to coordinate them kicking off a centralized automated test. So for the purposes of tuning the microwave, the bit error rate test is done much better at the cell site. And again, by doing the bit error rate test, you can really optimize that microwave for the best performance. Another thing that's quite common, mainly internationally, but even here in the United States and Canada for people that are using IEEE 1588 or PTP as a backup to satellite, is PTP. It's most microwaves that are deployed today do support functioning as a PTP boundary clock. And at the very minimum, it should be, you should configure your test set to talk to the PTP Grandmaster and run a wander analysis, a one and or two-way PDV analysis, a maximum time error analysis. And if you run into problems where things aren't working correctly, you can always go in and connect to any T1, 1 PPS or 10 megahertz ports on the baseband unit and do a wander analysis to make sure that it's properly configured and taking timing from the satellite, because most satellite connections go directly into the baseband unit. So it's a point of troubleshooting that could be done on the Ethernet. As far as the cable diagnostic test that I recommended and mentioned, usually you want to test the cable length. Make sure that the cable is under 100 meters and complies with IEEE 802.3 specifications. You want to make sure that it's pinned out correctly, and you want to make sure that there's continuous shield ground continuity all the way from one end of the RJ45 cable to the other. So with that end, we have an Ethernet peering partner that would serve as the far end device to the T-Bird 5800. That peering partner is a layer one traffic reflector or a layer one loopback when connected to the wire map port. When connected, of course, to the shield ground port, it just enables the shield ground continuity tests. And all the cable diagnostic tests are likewise integrated into the job manager, so they can be part of what you're reporting in when you are creating the summary report. So with that, I hopefully have given you a decent introduction to some of the challenges of front haul installation, given you a flavor for some of the recommendations that we have made as far as ensuring that you run an efficient, expedient, and as complete as possible test scenario at the cell site, with the hope of increasing the quality of the work. Again, my name is Joe Gomez. Feel free to reach out to me at joe.gomez@viavisolutions.com. Thank you very much.